All right, good evening, my dear friends.
Good evening, Pastor Carr.
Hi, Lanaya, how are you? Welcome to worship. Come on, let's see, this is the third weekend after Pentecost, after Epiphany. Welcome in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. A couple of announcements for you as we get started. Things going on in the life here at Immanuel. This coming Thursday evening is our January voters meeting at 6:30 in the parish hall. So it is a regularly scheduled voters meeting. So you could become a voter at that meeting if you would like. Let's see, that'll be 6:30 in the parish hall this Thursday. Let me see here. On Friday is the ILS Fire Night. That's the pre-information and re-enrollment night. So there's pizza dinner and presentation. That's at 5:30 in the gym this coming Friday. Let's see here. ILS auction.
March 4th.
What's that?
I know something.
Can you tell me something about it?
It's March 4th. It's going to be at Danamon this year.
Okay.
It's a Comic-Con theme.
Okay.
So come dress with your favorite book, superhero, or as yourself.
Okay, right.
And it's going to be super fun. And there's only a limited amount of tickets, so we'll have more details on that when we get our sushi.
Okay.
And still need people to make calls to some of our usual vendors. And she's got a script she'll give you. And if you know any businesses that would like to donate, we're always would love to get them.
Okay. Very good. I'm sure Carrie will pull that much soon and give us another. Thank you. That was really good. I think you did everything there. Maybe even better. Thank you so much. So, yeah, we have our ILS auction coming up. Just want to remind you, I'll keep reminding you, coming up on March 4th. Let's see. This is LCMS Life Weekend. In your bulletins, you should have a Life Weekend little insert here in your worship packet. Which talks about some important things. We are recognizing with LCMS churches around the country the importance of the life that God created. There was a March for Life in D.C. yesterday, which the LCMS took part in, and also our own Carol Tobias for Right for Life took part in. Just a reminder for that. So there's different passages and things that we can remember on this weekend and think about as we support the life that God made. So you got an insert in your bulletin. This is the month that Mr. Bartles turns 100 years old. Reminder, January 27th. So you can send him a happy birthday card. If you would like for us to get him a happy birthday card, you can bring that card to the office. And I will be taking it to him on his birthday. So, just a reminder for that. We did that. That is just about it. Let's see. Let us stand as we begin our worship. I sing.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Praise the Lord, all you nations. Extol him, all you peoples. For great is his love toward us, and the faithfulness of the Lord endures forever.
Praise the Lord.
The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes.
The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are sure and altogether righteous. They are more precious than gold, than much pure gold. They are sweeter than honey from the comb.
By them is your servant warned. In keeping them, there is great reward. Who can discern his errors?
Forgive my hidden faults. Keep your servant also from willful sins. May they not rule over me. Then I might be blameless, innocent of great transgression.
The heavens continually declare God's praise, and the forces of nature daily show forth his glory as they faithfully carry out the duties he has assigned them. Too bad we so often fail in the fulfillment of our divinely appointed tasks. God's forgiveness and grace, as revealed in his word, are glorious.
O Lord, my rock and my redeemer, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, through Jesus Christ. Amen.
With our hope and faith in the promise of the Lord, let us confess our sins to him. Father in heaven, you have said that we should love you with all our heart, soul, and strength, and to love our neighbor as ourselves. I confess that I have not obeyed your commands, and I have lived a worldly life, not one that reflects your light into the world. Father, forgive me of all my sins. I ask this in the name of my precious Lord and Savior, Jesus. Dear friends, take heart and know that you are loved. You are God's special possession. He has heard your cry for mercy. Because of God's deep love for you and the atoning sacrifice of Jesus, you are forgiven. You are set free from the bondage of your sin.
We sing to him, sing praise to him, tell of all his wonderful acts, glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice.
In grateful response, we sing.
Thank you.
be seated for the reading of God's Word. Our Old Testament reading tonight is from the book of the prophet Nehemiah, chapter 8, selected verses. All the people assembled as one man in the square before the water gate. They told Ezra the scribe to bring out the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded for Israel. So on the first day of the seventh month, Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly, which was made up of men and women and all who were able to understand. He read it aloud from daybreak till noon as he faced the square before the water gate in the presence of the men, women, and others who could understand. And all the people listened attentively to the book of the law. Ezra opened the book. All the people could see him, because he was standing above them, and as he opened it, the people all stood up. Ezra praised the Lord, the great God, and all the people lifted their hands and responded, "Amen, amen." Then they bowed down and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. The Levites read from the book of the law of God, making it clear and giving the meaning so that the people could understand what was being read. Then Nehemiah the governor, Ezra the priest and scribe, and the Levites who were instructing the people said to them all, "This day is sacred to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep, for all the people have been weeping as they listened to the words of the law." Nehemiah said, "Go and enjoy choice food and sweet drinks and send some for those who have nothing prepared. This day is sacred to our Lord. Do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength." Our epistle reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 12, continuing in the 12th verse. Paul says, "The body is a unit. Though it is made up of many parts, and though all its parts are many, they form one body. So it is with Christ. For we were all baptized by one Spirit into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, slave or free, and were all given the one Spirit to drink. Now the body is not made up of one part, but of many. If the foot should say, 'Because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body,' it would not for that reason cease to be part of the body. And if the ear should say, 'Because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body,' it will not for that reason cease to be part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? If the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? But, in fact, God has arranged the parts in the body, every one of them, just as he wanted them to be. If they were all one part, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, but one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, 'I don't need you.' And the head cannot say to the feet, 'I don't need you.' On the contrary, those parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And the parts that we think are less honorable, we treat with special honor. And the parts that are unpresentable are treated with special modesty, while our presentable parts need no special treatment. But God has combined the members of the body and has given greater honor to the parts that lacked it, so that there should be no division in the body, but that its parts should have equal concern for each other. If one part suffers, every part suffers with it. If one part is honored, every part rejoices with it. Now you are the body of Christ, and each one of you is a part of it. And in the church, God has appointed first of all apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then workers of miracles, also those having gifts of healing, those able to help others, those with gifts of administration, and those speaking in different kind of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all have gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret, but eagerly desire the greater gifts." Would you please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel tonight? Our Holy Gospel reading comes from Luke chapter 4, starting at the 16th verse. Jesus went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. And he stood up to read. The scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it was written. It is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners, and recovery of sight for the blind, to release the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Then he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. And he began by saying to them, "Today the scriptures are fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his lips. "Isn't this Joseph's son?" they asked. Jesus said to them, "Surely you will quote this proverb to me. Physician, heal yourself. Do here in your own town what we heard you have done in Capernaum." "I tell you the truth," he continued, "no prophet is acceptable in his hometown. I assure you that there were many widows in Israel in Elijah's time, when the sky was shut up for 3.5 years, and there was a severe famine throughout the land. Yet Elijah was not sent to any of them, but to a widow in Zarephath, in the region of Sidon. And there were many in Israel with leprosy in the time of Elisha, the prophet. Yet not one of them was cleansed, only Naaman, the Syrian." All the people in the synagogue were furious when they heard this. They got up, drove him out of the town, and took him to the brow of the hill on which the town was built in order to throw him down the cliff. But he walked right through the crowd and went on his way. This is our gospel reading for tonight. Please be seated. I want to invite our kids to come forward to join me for an object lesson tonight. Good to see you guys. Oh, that's great. You're dipping on socks. Very nice. All right. Last week, I want to remind you what I talked about last week. Last week we talked about gifts. That God gives gifts, and he doesn't just give them to some people, he gives them to all people. We all have gifts from the Spirit, and God wants us to use the gifts he gives us so that we can tell people about Jesus, right? So we talked about that last week. Today in our epistle reading, Paul continues that discussion, and he says, guess what the church is like? He says it's like a great big body. Do you guys like when your body is working like it should? Yeah, I do too. It reminds me sometimes of something like a team. Now, were you playing today? What were you playing? Basketball. You were playing basketball. Did you guys win?
Yes.
You did win. Did you guys play well together as a team? Good. When teams play together, it works really, really well. When teams don't play together, it doesn't really work very well. And it takes every single person on the team playing the game to make things happen. I was thinking about, I don't know, anybody watching any football this weekend? Yeah, football? Your dad was, okay. I was thinking about, my favorite player, Patrick Mahomes. He's very handsome and just talented in many ways. He's not going to get a single throw off tomorrow when we beat the Buffalo Bills if the offensive line doesn't guard him. They need to work together. I was also thinking about the way that teams, when somebody is sick, somebody is injured, things don't always work like they should. This is exactly what Paul is talking about tonight in the church. He says every single one of you, me, all the big kids out there, are like part of a big team. You're part of a body. So we think about our body, right? And maybe you are a pinky finger. Right? Maybe that's, do you guys ever use your pinky finger? God, you use it a lot more than you think you do. Have you ever grabbed something? Yeah. How do you play Switch without a pinky finger? You can't.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. You can't do it. I tried. I hurt my pinky the 5. So maybe you've got somebody who stands up in front of people and talks. But maybe you have somebody who works with numbers. Mr. Halbert counts our offerings every Monday morning. He does a very important job. We all have very important jobs to do. We have people that lead our praise. We have people that prepare the slides for the service. We have people that get ready our paperwork, who are filling for the people at home. It takes a lot of people to make the church run. And Paul wants us to remind us about that tonight, so that we would say, here's what he wants to say, ready? What part of the body am I? That's what he wants us to say. He wants to say, what can I do to tell people about Jesus and to help what is going on in the church? And so that's what we should be thinking about, okay? I want you to think about what part of the body you are and what you are good at. I know you were too little, but you were growing up. What am I good at? What could I do to serve Jesus and his church? Let's pray. Lord, we thank you that you have called us to be the body of Christ here on earth, the church. Lord, we ask that you would enable us, make us able, Lord, to serve you with the gifts you have given. We know you have given us gifts. We ask that you would help us to use them for your glory, whatever way that you help us to do that, Lord, that we would honor you. We thank you for this ability, and we ask that you would help us to work together like a body, to work together like a team, Lord, because we are all headed towards the same goal. We thank and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you, guys. You can return to your seats. I appreciate it. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you that you have called us together, not just to be here tonight, but you have called us by the waters of baptism, Lord, to be your own, to be those who are marked by Christ, those who are the church, those called out of the world in this time. You've made us a body, Lord, and we ask that you would enable us to find not only what we do and what we are in this body, but that we would respect and build up and love the whole body, Lord. That we would bring all things together in unity so that we might bless you, honor you, and extend your message of salvation to all people. Lord, I ask tonight that you would bless the words of my mouth and the meditations of each of our hearts. May it be pleasing and acceptable in your sight. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Last week we had the opportunity to hear about spiritual gifts. Spiritual gifts are those gifts from God given to us by the Spirit. They are distributed to all believers, we heard. They are distributed in the ways, in the time, and in the amount that God sees fit. We heard this last week from Paul, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, concerning spiritual gifts, he says, and in verse 11, all these are empowered by one and the same Spirit who apportions to each one individually as he that is the Holy Spirit, as he wills. So once again, I said last week, as a believer, as part of the church, the question is not, do I have a spiritual gift? The question is, how has God gifted me for the building up of the church? How has God gifted me to serve the person and the gospel of Jesus Christ? Dear friends, I want to encourage you again here tonight, no matter who you are, no matter where you are in your life, whether you are just starting your life, like the kids, or in the busy working years of your life, or are retired, no matter who you are, your gifts are to be used. That's the whole point. In fact, every time spiritual gifts is talked about in Scripture, it says use them. They are to be used. Paul anticipates the inevitable next question from us today in our epistle reading. Okay, we all have gifts. Those gifts are to be used. So where and how do we use them? I want to start tonight by saying this. There are many and various ways to use your spiritual gifts, no matter what that gift is. Maybe it's music or teaching or hospitality or administration. Maybe you're a numbers person. Thanks be to God for them. Maybe you know how to fix a sink or can crunch numbers. No matter what your gift is, there are ways to use your spiritual gifts out there in the world. There's plenty of ways to use them. God has given us the gift of vocation, and living in God-pleasing ways in our vocation often intersects with the world around us, being faithful employees, bosses, neighbors, citizens, on and on. But in 1 Corinthians, Paul is very much clear about his purpose and focus in his letter to the church. He says, I'm writing specifically to the church. He was writing to a specific church, the church in Corinth, and writing for the whole church by extension. So where our epistle reading today takes us is this question. How can I and why should I use my gifts for the church? And that's where I'd like to go with Paul. From verses 12 through 13 in our epistle reading, now this is the ESV version here, He says, for just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is, he says, with Christ. For in one spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and all were made to drink of one spirit. The controlling metaphor for the rest of chapter 12 is this: a body. A perfect and timeless metaphor. Everybody has a body, and everyone knows what it means in various degrees, what it means when the body is not working like it should. When the body is functioning like it should, when we're firing on all cylinders, boy, it is a beautiful, blessed thing. But when it is not, when a member of the body is hurting or not functioning like it should, or like doing its own thing, it affects the whole body, says Paul. So about this body, where and when did we enter it? When did we enter the church? Paul says you entered it in baptism. Baptism is the great equalizer when it comes to the kingdom of God. Why is it the great equalizer? Different people with different gifts, different abilities, different likes, passions, and struggles in this life, we all come to the same font of Jesus Christ. And there, our sinful nature, our individual nature, and the things that separate men and cause division among us, there die. They are put to death there. They are drowned. And what arises is one marked by Christ. A member of his body, a part of the church. Now, losing our individual importance to Christ or unique place in this world, but rising out of the waters of baptism with the indelible mark of Christ upon us, and having been connected not just to Christ, but to the rest of the body. Galatians chapter 3, verse 27 says, for as many of you were baptized into Christ, have put on Christ. I'm going to wear this tomorrow. Can you see this well enough, Mr. Halbert?
Yeah.
Who is it? Okay.
It doesn't say Cowboys, does it?
It does not say Cowboys, no sir. I'm going to wear this tomorrow. And wearing this beautiful, attractive jersey doesn't make me Patrick Mahomes, does it? No, not really. It makes me a fan of his. That's what it makes me, right? Go, Patrick, go, Chiefs. Wearing this gorgeous jersey doesn't put me on the Chiefs team, does it? I waited all week, but Andy Reid has not called me yet. I've been waiting. I thought he was going to ask for my opinion on this week's game, and Travis Kelce has not texted me all week. That's not the way baptism is, but I'm afraid sometimes that's the way we think about the church. In baptism, this is not the way we put on Christ. In baptism, we are intimately connected with Christ. Not as a fan, but as a follower or a disciple, even better. And he not only knows our name, I don't think old Patrick knows my name. He not only knows our name, he puts his name on us. In baptism, putting on Christ puts us on the team, on the eternal team. And my friends, in the church, we all, no matter if we have good taste in football or not, we all are on the same team, which not only just covers us, but it really identifies us with Jesus and with one another. Being saved by Christ connects us to one another in an intimate way, therefore, Paul says. So how intimate is this intimate connection with one another in the body of Christ? Well, Paul says it this way. It's so intimate, if one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. How does this play out in our physical bodies? Well, we probably have experienced this. I'm a pretty tough guy, I think. I feel like I am. But I have been doubled over with a screaming tooth before. Baby cries out. I've learned the new way of life that is walking with a broken pinky toe. I hurt my knee one time, which caused me to walk in a way that I threw my back out, which caused me in a way to walk in a way which hurt my other knee, and my body was like, not liking any, but we're not having any. The body matters. Every part of the body matters. Every part of the body is connected. And we, the church, are not like, but we are a big body, says Paul. In the same way, we've seen people who lose part of their body, lose a sense, a functioning of their body, and then different parts of the body pick up the slack. I miss our blind outreach Bible studies. I have been on an extended vacation during COVID. It never ceases to amaze me that those who have lost sight, or maybe never had sight, have heightened sense of hearing and identify me by my footfalls and my probably huffing and puffing when I walk too. Hi, Pastor, they say. How do they even know? And we, the church, are a big body, says Paul. The rabid individualism of our American society teaches against this. Everything about it teaches against this. But here's the truth, brothers and sisters. What you do affects people in the church around you. Your sin affects the people in the church around you. Your joy affects the people in the church around you. Your struggle and sickness and presence and absence affects people in the church around you. And some people might be listening online who are able to be here in the body, and that is where you should be. You should be back here with us in the body. Your absence has not, I assure you, gone unnoticed. We absolutely cannot do things in the church, for the church, as the church, that doesn't affect one another and the wider church. And all this body talk that Paul has, being a body, being a unit, a collective, it may lead us to think that there is no individual importance anymore, that we are not individually valued. On the contrary, the beauty of the body metaphor is that we know how important each individual, each piece of the body is. Paul says, for the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, yet one body. The eye needs the pancreas. The lungs need the heart. The muscles need our digestive system. Everything is interconnected, and so it is with the church. We need ushers and greeters and the altar guild and the teachers and the preachers and the musicians. We need people to watch and invest money. We need those to take care of our grounds and to plan VBS. We need those to clean floors and those to lock and unlock doors. You are part of the body, and what Paul is really trying to say is nobody can be you. Nobody can fill the unique niche that you fill. You have an important and distinct role in the body of Christ. And this body, the Christian church on earth, is something much bigger than just an organization, okay? We're not that. The church plays a much bigger role than membership. The church, the bride of Christ, was redeemed, was adorned with salvation, life, and everlasting righteousness by the bridegroom, Jesus Christ, for one reason. The church has been made the church to be the body, yes, but not just any body, the body of Christ in the world today. So Paul says this in verse 27, now you are the body of Christ. Now you should be, just like you are. You are the body of Christ and individually members of it. The church is the visible manifestation of the ascended Christ. Is Christ gone? Not really. Has he ascended? Yes. We are the body of Christ. We continue the mission, the ministry of Jesus Christ. In the same way we yearn for the coming of our King, we ought to find him where he can be found now, in the church. In the same way we are looking for healing and restoration, for complete righteousness and the coming of Christ, the church ought to be devoted here and now in helping others in their every physical need, aiding individuals in putting pieces of their life back together, and extending the forgiveness that has been given to the church to distribute freely on behalf of Christ. Here's the truth. You, the church, the body of Christ, might be the first and only Christ that people see. That should stress you out just a little bit, because it doesn't mean. You, the church, the body of Christ, might be the first and only Christ that people see. And when people wanted to know the rabbi, wanted to know what it was all about, they would go not to the rabbi, but to his disciples. That's the way it worked. So it is with the church. You are the disciples of Christ. You have been clothed with Christ, identified by Christ, and identified with Christ. So the body of Christ, let your light shine. Be who God created you to be with the gifts of the Spirit, that God has lavished upon you. Every single member of this body matters. Has a role, has a unique function. Every single member of this body is valued, is needed, is cherished by God, despite the sinfulness of man. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 is about the ways that God gifts every single member of his church, aka spiritual gifts. It's about the gift that is every single member of his church, the body of Christ, and how we function together in this time to prepare for the eternal kingdom. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, it was written by Paul to the church in Corinth to address divisions in the church over spiritual gifts, over who is cooler than another, who is better than another. Paul says all spiritual gifts are the same importance, because they are given by God as he wills to the church, and all members, every single member of the body, the church on earth, matters and are integral to the overall functioning of the church, to image and manifest Christ is ministry here and now. And then at the end of chapter 12, in the last verse, Paul takes all of that teaching, everything he talked about, all of the body stuff, all of the gift stuff, and he loads it into his big, powerful gun of rhetoric, and he prepares to unleash it in chapter 13, which will be next week. This is how he prepares us. The first verse of 1 Corinthians chapter 12, he says, concerning spiritual gifts, I don't want you to be uninformed, he says. The last verse, he says this, 31. But earnestly desire the higher gifts. I don't want you to be informed. Earnestly desire the higher gifts. And I'm about to show you a still more excellent way. What is that? Well, you'll have to tune in next week. Until then, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Lord, we ask that you would enable us as the body in Christ not only to receive and use the gifts you give to us, but that we might do it for the building up of the church around us, for our brothers and sisters gathered in your name, so that we might shine your light into this world, so that they might see our good deeds, that they might see our working, they might see everything that you have equipped us to do, and give glory to our Father in heaven. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity. We ask that you would bless us, forgive us where we fail, and encourage us, Lord, where we need to be strengthened. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us stand and sing.
Sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge
for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Lord God of Zion, we give you thanks that you have arisen to show pity to our fallen world, setting us free from our sin and death. In Christ, the appointed time of favor has come for all people. Cause your name to be declared among all peoples, that your grace may not be rejected in our time, but received with delight in every place. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, your people in the days of Ezra the priest returned to your word with attentive ears. Give us eagerness to hear your word with understanding, that our days may be sanctified and your commandments put into practice among us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy Father, you have arranged us as members of one body in Jesus Christ. Free us from jealousy or contempt toward our fellow Christians. Lead us to bestow honor on our weaker brothers, to suffer and rejoice together, and to serve in harmony as those baptized into one Spirit. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, this weekend we join together with faithful Christians in our country professing the sanctity of life. The life that you have created from conception until natural death. Put away from us, Lord, abortion and physician-assisted suicide and anything which takes away the life of your valuable and beloved creation until the day that death is finally conquered at the coming of Christ. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O God, give wisdom and courage to all who govern our communities and country, that they may lead well, following your will rather than man's whims. Grant us willingness to support them with our prayers and encouragement. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious and compassionate Lord, comfort those who mourn. As our great physician, mend the bodies and uplift the spirits of all who are in need. Lord, we ask that you continue to be with our brother Alan Ballard in this continual healing, and that you would relieve the swelling in his legs, Lord, and the many medical things he's enduring in this time, that you would be with him and bless him. We thank you that he is here with us tonight. Lord, we ask that you bless all those who are sick and suffering with COVID or any other sickness, Lord, that they might be lifted up in your gracious arms for healing. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
All this we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Christ unites us in baptism and makes us his very body. Though wounded and afflicted, his body can never be destroyed, but carries out God's loving purposes.
Grant me refuge, dear Jesus, in your holy wounds, from which you poured life and blessing for me and for all. Teach me to love and serve all people humbly, according to my call. Amen.
The Almighty and Merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless you and keep you now and forever.
Amen.
And we sing our final song.
Thank you.
cares about you has been blessed with a brand new director. And Ramon is here to say, to welcome. We're welcoming him, and he's going to say thank you and tell us a little bit about himself.
Hi, good afternoon, good evening. Yes, he's saying good morning. Germán Montiel, the new director, has got his value the mission that Emmanuel support for the mission. And so I'm here to say thank you. Really quick, I just want to say, a new director, I met my wife serving, and that was 15 years ago, it seems, more or less. And, you know, it's always been just their serving. And so all of a sudden, I was called to this position, so I started thinking about the body, and so the sermon was hopefully again tomorrow because it was very nice. I would be here in the morning. And then they came more body. So, I'll be back. We will be back regularly in a couple of months just so you can see me, just like so you can say thank you and tell you what we're hoping to do with the mission. That'll be future. For today, this visit is all about the thank yous for everything that Emmanuel does to support the mission. The Christmas event, if you guys, I think the Emmanuel thing is coming up with our donations that we're arriving, and that was, and we had more than enough, but you guys provided it because of your grace. So thank you for that. Mr. Nolan, Schrader's class, students, the servant events, and that was wonderful. They came down to mission, and they organized clothes, made hygiene packets, several other things, labeled, which was wonderful because we